Good morning, good morning, good morning.
How's everybody doing today?
Great.
We're great. All right, it's time to praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You guys excited? It's another great Sunday to be in the house of God, to be here, to give Him the praises. The fact that we woke up with our physical abilities. What does that old song say? It says we woke up clothed and in our right mind. I mean, in a day and an age where people's mental faculties are tested every day, to wake up in your right mind is truly a blessing. I send you greetings from Elder Spears, who is out of town this week, so I get to open up for him today. He may be watching, so happy Sunday to you, Elder Spears. He should be back this week. But we do want to welcome you all here to the house of God. We pray that you had a wonderful week. And you know what? Even if you didn't have quite a great week, we want you to know that God is still good.
Amen.
That through the ups, through the downs, that our God is good, our God is mighty, our God is wonderful, and He is here for all of our ups, our downs, our highs, our lows, our joys, and our woes. Our God is here for us. So as we prepare today to just worship together, we prepare to get together, let's unite in prayer today. Let's unite this morning in one accord. I know that there's a lot going on in our micro world and our macro worlds. So we're just going to go to God in prayer at this time and just ask for His blessings, His grace, and just ask that His favor may be upon us this morning. Amen? So let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for today, Lord, this glorious day where we can wake up, Father God. We have a place where we can come and we can worship, Lord. We thank you for the heat that we have in this building. It's a little cool outside. We thank you for a roof over our head that's not leaking. Lord, you sent the rain. We appreciate the rain so much. You know what we need, and you give us what we need every time. Even many times when we don't ask, you still give us what we need. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you for this great body of people that are here today that are gathered in your name, Father God. Many today have come searching for something. Lord, and I pray that the search ends today by finding you. Lord, we know that in you, we have everything that we could ever need in this life. And we pray that we all might realize and see that here today, Lord, that as we interact with you today, Father God, we're not just sitting back and enjoying a show, Lord, but we're actively giving to you, Father God, through worship, through scriptures, through offerings, through prayers. We give to you today, Lord, and we pray that through these acts, Father God, that we may be changed. As your Spirit is here moving amongst us this morning, we just pray that a change will come to people, Lord. I know somebody's going to come through those doors today that needs a relationship with you, Lord. Many feel they have that. Many feel that because they know of the church and they know of you that they're okay, Father God. But we know that it is only those who are truly in Christ who are okay. Those that have a relationship with your Son. Those are the ones that you're going to come back for when it's that time, Lord. So I pray that we all might have such a relationship with you so that we all can rejoice here on earth together and rejoice together in heaven. Lord, we lift up our world today, Lord. We know so many things are happening. We continue to hear of wars and rumors of wars, Lord. But we take heart, as you told us to take heart, because these are just signs of the end times. These are just reminders that you are still working and that you will return for us one day, Lord. The evils that we may see in this world are only temporary. We know that your goodness, your holiness is eternal. And we look forward to that day when you crush the devil completely under your feet. You remove his presence from our lives. And we can worship you in truth and in honesty. Thank you for this day, Father God, for just a glimpse of what that's going to look like. And we just pray that lives will be touched, not just here in this building, but for all over the world. For those that are watching online, Lord, we pray that your Spirit will be with them as well, that they may praise us, Lord, wherever they are. They may feel you, that they may come to know you a little bit better than they did yesterday. We give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. We pray these things in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. So, are we ready to worship today? I'm ready to worship. I don't know about you. I'm always ready to worship. I'm always ready to give to the Lord. Amen. We're going to invite our praise team to come on up. And we invite you to stand, to rock, to sing, wherever you are across this building today. For all of our friends of God, we want you to praise the Lord with us today. Amen.
Amen.
sees us and he loves it when we give him the praise. We can lift our voices to so many others. I'm not going to name any artists, but you guys know who you sing. You know who you listen to out there. But when we give it to God, God is so much more pleased because we're giving it to him. The one that made us, the one that gave us our voices, our minds, our abilities. And when we give it back to him, he loves that so much. And you know what? You become inspirational to the next person. Because that next person may be sitting there wondering, how is it that they can praise God like that? And what's stopping me from doing the same thing? Some people may know your story. Some people may know what you've been through and are still wondering, how can you praise God when everything that you've been through hasn't been good? But when we praise him, we give him the glory and give inspiration to others. So let's continue to praise him here today. One thing that we know is that love is going to remain. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us that all these other things may pass away, but love remains. And you may ask yourself, how is it that outside of everything else, love is the one thing that remains? Well, 1 John 4 tells us that God is love. And we know that God is going to remain. So let us remain in God, remain in his love that is there for us forever. God's love is there. Let's just take hold of that today. It's never going to fail. It's never going to run out on us. I know we may have some people in our lives that we looked upon and we depended upon to be there. And because of their humanness, they might not have shown up. God always shows up for you. Always shows up. It may not look like we think it ought to look, but if we look close enough, we will see that God is there.
Trials and
Give you the praise, Lord, where we can worship together as one body, Father God. And even though we are here as Inglewood Southside Christian Church, Lord, we represent a bigger body that is worldwide. that is a body of believers all across this globe of people who lift your name on high, Lord. I pray for every one of our brothers and sisters around this globe. I know it's not easy walking this walk, but Lord, we know that we'll never do it on our own. Let us lean into your strength, Lord, the strength that you provide so freely to us, Father God. And let us walk with integrity, Lord, in the face of everything. Let us remember what Daniel and the Hebrews went through, Lord, while they were in the midst of Babylon. They still did not bend the knee to you, to others, Lord. They just bowed to you. They gave you the praise in the face of even death. So, Lord, I pray that we may have that type of conviction, that type of boldness, Lord. We know that it feels like our world is caving in on us and trying to make us submit to its rules. Well, Lord, let us stand on your word every day. Give us the strength, give us the courage, Father God. And for those moments when we've turned away from you, Lord, we ask your forgiveness. And remind us that we can come back to you and start afresh every day, every moment. We give you the praise in this day. Thank you for everyone gathered here under the sound of my voice, Lord. I pray blessings upon your people, Father God, and as we are blessed here in this place, may we be a blessing to someone else, someone who wasn't able to come in today and to get this. May we give it to them, Lord, as you have filled us up. It's not for our own benefit or our own purposes, but it's so that the world may recognize that you are the one true living God, and you are a God that is worthy of praise and worthy to be served. So thank you for what you're doing right now in this place. We love you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray these things. Amen. Just happy. I'm excited. We got a wonderful service planned for you today. And I know each and every week we have a great service, but this is no exception. We have another great service today. Are you ready for the service? Are you ready for what's going to happen? I don't know if you're ready. I don't know if you have any idea what God is trying to do today. You're going to see some things today that I hope are very inspirational to you.
Amen.
And I want you to keep in mind that what you see, God is working through.
Amen.
God is speaking. God is moving. Y'all heard God move today with our musicians. I bet y'all didn't know that Chris could play like that. And I know Chris was holding back. He wasn't giving you like everything. He's that good. Trevor just orchestrates it all. Comes in with the back beats and everything else. You would have thought we had a drummer up here. Got the beat going. And Brother John just cool in his little seat. I don't know if you can see his hat over here. We got that cool hat over here. You know, John just sits back on that bass and he just makes it go. So we thank you guys as always. Treasure. I mean, I said it before, I'll say it again. You can't get this everywhere.
Amen.
You can't get this everywhere.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Do we have any April birthdays in the house? April birthdays? Charles, happy birthday. Is it this week? Your birthday this week? I know I got it in my calendar. I have to look at it. Charles is getting old. I remember when Charles was like Xavier size and smaller when he first came. Getting old. Good job, Charles. Got some big things coming from Charles soon. Keep Charles in prayer. Love you, Charles. And for all of our April birthdays, happy birthday.
Amen.
Again, thank you for having a birthday. Gives me just another reason to celebrate, and if I have to, I'm gonna find me a piece of gluten-free, dairy-free, nut-free birthday cake, and I'm gonna eat it in your honor. You may not want to eat. Actually, you know what? I go to a bakery that makes them really nice. They're delicious. Like, they don't. For some people, you say gluten-free, and they think cardboard. This is not cardboard. It actually tastes good. So I will eat a piece of that birthday cake in your honor. So thank you for having a birthday. Welcome to all of our visitors today. For all those that have come in, it's your first time or whatever. We thank you for joining us today in this house. For all of our online viewers, thank you for watching online. I want to give a shout out to Brother Bruce Tanner Gross, all the way from Arizona. Thank you for tuning in each and every week. As he would say, go Dodgers. He's a big Dodger fan, so go Dodgers. We got Dodger fans in the house today. Yeah. How we feeling? We feeling good? I didn't stay up to see what happened in the game last night.
They won.
Good. Beat the Padres. Do we have any San Diego Padres fans in the house? No? Okay. Dodgers. How about Angels? Got Angel fans? No, we all Dodgers. Okay. If it's baseball, we're Dodgers. Okay. Clipper fans, how we feeling? Clipper fans, hey, y'all don't have to go to a play-in. So that's good, right? No play-in for the Clippers. Laker fans, how we feeling? I mean, to be the master of your own destiny and drop the ball, but then to still see some kind of favor to where the teams you needed to lose lost, so you're not like totally out of it. I hope they make the most of what's been handed to them on the silver platter. I mean, they are absolutely the masters of their own destiny. So whatever happens at this point is on the Lakers. Win or lose, it's on them. I talked to my cousin Chris. He's shaking his head. He's like, man, I don't know about these guys. I don't know either. I'm going to just continue to ride this roller coaster that we're doing with the Lakers. Oh, I did have another question because I saw a mock draft. Now, mock draft don't mean much for the NFL. Raiders fans. Raiders fans, let's slide that. Raiders, Trent, all right. Shanero. I saw in the mock draft that you guys are projected to get Bo Nix from Oregon. How you feel about that? Good play? Good quarterback. I think they need it. You guys need a quarterback, yeah? Yeah, you need some other pieces to fall into place as well. I'm not a Raiders fan, but I'm not a Raiders hater either. And I really thought they could have done something and nothing. But we'll see what this season brings about. And that's our life, right? We can have mock drafts in our life. We can set up things. We can project things in our life and figure that this is going to happen. This will line up and that will line up. But God has a way of working around that. And God tends to, as we say, laugh when we make plans. And he says, you have no idea what I have in store for you.
Amen.
And sometimes we just have to roll with it. We have to trust that God is doing what's best for us and roll with it. So I don't know where you are in your life, where your plans are in your life, if your plans have been totally wiped out or if you're kind of still on track, just know that through everything, God is still with you.
Amen.
So mock draft or no in your life, trust God. Amen?
Amen.
All right, we're going to move ahead in our services today. It's the time that we have at Inglewood Southside Christian Church. It's a time of communion. We come together each and every Lord's Day to commemorate the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
This is a portion of service that is open to all baptized believers. So if you are a baptized believer in Jesus Christ, whether you are baptized here at this local body or somewhere else, whether you're 5 or 105, you're more than welcome to partake in this portion of service with us. If you are in-house and you have not yet received a communion kit, please hold up your hand so that our ushers on the hospitality crew can get you a communion kit. If you're watching online, gather your emblems together. Again, welcome. Thank you for joining us. I will stop at this moment for you online viewers to remind you to like, share, and subscribe, as that helps our channel. Helps our channel to get the gospel out further and further and further. And that's exactly what we want to do, share the gospel message with as many people as we can.
Amen.
So as we prepare to go into our community meditation, I want you to give a big hand, round of applause to somebody that's new to doing this. So make him feel welcome. He's going to bring a great message from God. So we want to welcome Brother Billy Bolden today to give us our community meditation.
First of all, beautiful to see all you guys here. Again, Pastor, family, thank you guys for again welcoming me into the family.
Amen.
A little nervous, you know, but I'm going to get through it. Read scriptures. Today's scriptures from Romans 6, 8 and 14. If you have the Bibles, turn to it. Now, if we die with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, we cannot die. He cannot die again. Mm-hmm. Death no longer has mastery over him. Mm-hmm. The death he died. He died to sin once for all. Mm-hmm. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourself dead to sin, but alive in God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from the death to life, and offer parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. For sin cannot be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace.
Amen.
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 Let's take a few seconds to meditate over this, and we offer thanks to God for his grace and mercy. Save our souls, Father God, we greatly appreciate it. And as we take in, we remember each week the love you have for us and the love you continue to have for us. So we thank you, we praise you, we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Right now, take your communion. Thank you.
reminder, if you are a part of the Communion Meditation Ministry, you have a meeting today in the third building in room 301 following this morning's services.
Amen. Amen.
And then this Saturday, we have our third Saturday prayer breakfast meeting at 9:30 a.m. And then as you came in, you received a flyer regarding Healthy Eating Resource Fair. It'll be held on April 18th from 2:30 to 4:30. The address is there. It looks like if you participate in the fair, you'll receive a $20 grocery gift card. That'll get you 2 cartons of eggs. So you should definitely go because every little bit helps, right, in this economy. Okay. That concludes my announcements. I would like to welcome all of our visitors. We look forward to meeting with you all after services today in our Linger Longer. Thank you.
Eggs have gotten expensive. Actually, you know they do. Eggs fluctuate in price. Did you guys know that? Did you ever pay attention to that? Well, I do because I buy them for a giveaway. And depending on the week, they're way up here. As opposed to the next week, they're down here. They fluctuate. Yeah, five dozen carton will go anywhere from $12 up to $20, depending on the time of week. Yeah, they do. Just want you to know that. I'm glad to be here this morning. I see my son is trying to outdo me. I'm the number one Dodger fan. Let's not forget that. Amen. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord again, isn't it not?
Yeah.
Amen. I do want to first of all say thank you to all of you, Southside, for what you do. We did our giveaway yesterday, so thanks to all of you. We were able to service 75 families. Thank you all for all of your gifts, and those who are behind the scenes doing things, putting boxes together, washing vegetables, and just having fun, falling out and laughing, stuff like that. It's a lot of work that goes into it, but thank you all because those families are blessed and God is being blessed, and we know more praise is being given to Him. It's just amazing that all that goes in behind the scenes, weeks is done in 15 minutes. When we start the giveaway, 15 minutes later, we're done. So we know there's a great need, so we want to just continue to pray on that as well. But thanks to all of you who volunteer your time and effort. I do want to also remind you that tomorrow is tax day. I don't even make any money. I still have to pay taxes. But just so you know, tomorrow's tax day. Amen. And I do think I see Miss Donna Castillo with us. Amen. Welcome back home. Welcome back home, Miss Donna. Like I said, she's been away, but she's been faithfully every Sunday morning she's been viewing where she's been away, but she's back home. Amen. Thank you for being with us. Amen. We're going to give you a chance to stretch your legs as we enter this portion of worship, which is the time of giving. And hopefully you prepared yourself in terms of what you're going to give. We know God loves a cheerful giver, amen?
Yeah.
And as we often say, if you don't want to give, please don't. We're not begging. We're not going to harass anybody. We're not going to threaten anybody. We want you to be cheerful in terms of what you're going to give to God. And we know God is generous to us. He's given us His greatest gift, His Son. Yeah. And we can't beat God giving. So I hope you prepared yourself. If you're going to give online, if you're going to give the old way, we're going to ask you to still fill out an envelope. Whether you did it online or whether you're doing it the old-fashioned way today, putting cash or whatever in, please fill out an envelope and put it in the offering kiosk here, over here. That way we can have a record of what you're giving and send it to where you want it to go. Amen? As we prepare for this time, I want to give you something to stretch your legs and talk to one another about. It's a question that will deal with today's message. And we've got something planned special today. I'm not speaking. You're supposed to say, oh, jeez. Y'all supposed to say, oh, like it's a big letdown. Y'all like, woohoo! But we do have a great speaker. We have a great presentation prepared for you today. Amen?
Amen.
So we're going to prepare you for that. And the question comes from our speaker today. And they want you to ask one another, during the course of this past week, You know, it's a saying, you know, you ask yourself, do rose bushes have thorns, or do thorn bushes have roses? Mm-hmm. Amen? So the question I want you to ask one another is, from your week, share one rose and one thorn. From your week, from your weeks of events, share one rose event, one thorn event. Amen? So we're going to give you a chance to share as we visit the offering kiosk. And please, do share. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, we're so grateful to you, Lord.
Amen.
We can't beat you giving, Lord God. It was you who gave us, Amen. Father God. You who made us in your image, Father God. And then you breathed into us the breath of life, Father God. And Father God, you brought us here, Father God, today. As family, Lord God, we come from different walks of life, Lord God, from different locations, Lord God. But Father, one thing, we're all family because we're covered by the blood of Jesus, Father God. So we thank you, Father God, we can be with our brothers and sisters, Lord, and praise you, Father God, to the highest. And we pray, Father God, thus far we've offered has been pleasing to you, Lord God. Pray you might continue to pour out your blessings, Father God, on one another, on us here today, Lord. That no one, Father, will leave here the way they entered in, Lord God. Father, some of us came in with heavy hearts, Lord God. Some of us came with confused, Lord God. Some of us came, Father God, with clouds or seeds of doubt, Lord God. I just pray that somehow through this service you will minister to each and every spirit, Lord God. Mm-hmm. I pray through the message, Lord God, that spirits will be lifted, Lord God, Amen. And elevated, Lord God. Mm-hmm. Faith will be increased, Lord God. So use our speaker, Lord God, in the way, Father God, that you will, Father God, receive the glory and the honor, Lord God, Amen. And your people will be blessed, Lord. So we prepare now, Father God, to share in this time of worship called giving, Father God, in terms of offering, in terms of tithes, Lord God. We just pray, Father God, that what we give, Lord God, you will take and bless and multiply, Father, to meet the needs that you called this congregation to serve, Lord God. We saw it yesterday, Lord God. We see other needs, Lord God. And we thank you, Father God, that we can use it for your glory, Lord. We just pray that it will result in more praise to you, Father God, even to the saving of souls, Father God, here locally and around the world. So thank you, Father God, for the gift. Thank you for the giver, Lord God. And Father God, may you be, most of all, be praised. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So you may now share one rose, one thorn from your week.
Amen.
Morning, family.
Good morning.
Can you all hear me?
Yes.
All right. I am excited to be here. I'm nervous, just like Billy was, of course. That is why I am dressed casually, because last time I was up here probably years ago in praise and worship, and I wore heels, and I felt like my legs were gonna buckle the whole entire time. So I was like, I'm gonna be comfortable and make sure that I don't feel that, at least.
Amen.
I'm gonna introduce myself. First, professionally, I am a licensed marriage and family therapist. I am a clinical training director and lecturer at a local university, which means I support students in graduate school who are wanting to become therapists. And a lot of my work has been in community mental health before I moved over to becoming a clinical training director and lecturer. And then I see private clients on the side, mostly adults and couples. Personally, you are gonna get to know me better throughout this message, and by the end of it, you'll know a lot about me. I really want to thank Brother Box for this opportunity to share and speak, for highlighting mental health as part of our wellness and wholeness. Mm-hmm. These past few years, even these past few months leading up to today, I am humbled by how far God has brought me on my own mental health journey. Yeah. And I stand before you confident in the ways I hope to encourage you today. Mm-hmm. Not only because of my professional experience, but because of my personal experience and my personal relationship with God.
Amen.
In Matthew 22, 37 to 40, Jesus said, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments."
Amen.
So how do we love well when we are struggling with our mental health? How is our relationship with God? Are we doing the work to love ourselves so that we can love others well? Before we get started, I wanted you to take a look at your outline. There is a check-in box. And I want you to take a moment to check in with yourself before we start. On one end, it says, "I need support." And on the other, opposite end, it says, "Feeling supported." No one's gonna grade you, so your first mind, whatever that is. Okay, and now I wanna go back to the beginning, specifically to Genesis 3. I think we're all pretty familiar with Genesis 3. In my Bible, it's entitled "The First Sin and Its Punishment." "Now the serpent was more crafty than any other wild animal that the Lord had made. He said to the woman, 'Did God say, you shall not eat from any tree in the garden?' The woman said to the serpent, 'We may eat of the fruit of the trees in the garden.' But God said, 'You shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, nor shall you touch it, or you shall die.' Mm-hmm. But the serpent said to the woman, 'You will not die, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil.' So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of its fruit and ate. And she also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made loincloths for themselves. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden at the time of the evening breeze. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, 'Where are you?' He said, 'I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself.' He said, 'Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?' The man said, 'The woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me fruit from the tree, and I ate.' Then the Lord God said to the woman, 'What is this that you have done?' The woman said, 'The serpent tricked me, and I ate.' The Lord God said to the serpent, "Because you have done this, cursed are you among all animals and among all wild creatures. Upon your belly you shall go, and dust you shall eat all the days of your life." I'm going to skip over some of this, okay? And then I'm going to go down to verse 20. The man named his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living. And the Lord God made garments of skin for the man and for his wife and clothed them. And then the Lord God said, "See, the man has become like one of us, knowing good and evil. And now he might reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." Therefore, the Lord God sent him forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. He drove out the man, and at the east of the Garden of Eden, he placed the cherubim and a sword flaming and turning to guard the way to the tree of life. So we all know this story. Probably no matter where you are in your walk, we're familiar with the fall, basically. And we can go to the second slide. Because we can learn a few things from Genesis chapter 3. And the few things that we can learn are that, one, shame is as old as time. Shame thrives undercover. And shame is defeated through Christ. We learn all of this in just this one chapter. We know this is a turning point in the story of God. One word added or subtracted by the serpent, and Eve was convinced of what he said over what God already told her. And Adam followed. They knew they'd done wrong, and the first thing they did was hide from our Creator. But God already knows and sees all. Amen. So he's asking us to come out of hiding. Amen. Before God set consequences in motion for Adam and Eve, he took care of the serpent, and he foreshadowed redemption for mankind through Jesus. That quickly, he lavished his grace and mercy on us. So it's time to learn the lessons and walk in purpose and newness. Mm-hmm. I'm taking us back to the beginning because our histories matter. If we can still blame Adam and Eve for some of the things we're going through today, because we've all kind of said that, blame them for something we're going through now, we have to know our more immediate stories impact us too. And when we experience and observe and witness people in a moment, we have to assume that there's so much more to their story that we don't know. So there's a running joke with some of my friends, and Ronique will know what I'm talking about, that I am the blue character from Inside Out. And if you're familiar with the movie, the blue character is Sadness. It's a joke, but there's always truth in jest, right? And I'm okay with that, because it's true. I know my history, and I'm aware that I have to fight a little harder than maybe some other people to access joy. So I'll tell you a little bit about myself. My parents were married in the 60s when interracial marriage was barely a thing. My mom's family disowned her, and we didn't have too many close family on my dad's side either growing up. Some were here in LA, but most of his family's actually in Texas. My first memories as a child were of being homeless. When my dad passed away, my brother's schizophrenia surfaced fully. I don't think my dad was ever diagnosed with anything, but we all know someone who struggles, and maybe we never found out what they had or what to call it, but there was something that they were struggling with. Mm-hmm. And I think that's more common in some of the older generations. Now that's becoming more easy to talk about. And I eventually found out that my maternal grandmother committed suicide when my mom was in her early 20s. I didn't grow up with a lot of affection or attention. The love I received was mostly from people outside of my family, at school, things like that. And then after doing my ancestry, DNA, I was connected with a distant cousin on my mom's side who gave me some insight into her family history. So her family came from a place called Prussia. I think that's what it was called at the time. And a lot of them actually moved out of the area and ended up in the Holocaust. And you can imagine my father's family history includes slavery. And this is just the history that I know. I went away to college at 17, and a lot of what I'd been through and lacked in love up to that point in time came to a head. I ended up starting therapy, It was free in college, so that was amazing. And it's a good resource, too, if you are in school. But I also started taking medication for depression at that time. And I did it for a period of time. I was able to wean myself off of it. And that's not something grand. This is just my experience. Medication is helpful. And if you need medication, it is a tool that can help improve your mental health 100%. So with all that being said, yes, I lean toward being blue. We can't escape our histories. They live in our cells and in our bones. Amen. But we can be healed and strengthened in the Lord and in community.
Amen.
There's generational trauma and there's generational healing. Okay, we can go to the next slide. What does this have to do with our mental health? We can go to the next slide. In the words of Brother Box, I'm glad you asked. So often we believe emotions and feelings are the enemy. There's something in the psychology world called the cognitive triangle, and it says that our thoughts impact our feelings, and our feelings impact our behavior. And God is clear in his word about the significance of our thought life and heart space. There are lots of scriptures around that. In Luke 6:45, we're reminded that the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. Uh-huh. In 2 Corinthians 10:5-6, he tells us to destroy every obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. In Romans 12:2, he tells us not to conform to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of our mind. There's a Christian therapist and author that I follow on Instagram who has her own personal experience with trauma, and she shared something recently that I feel was very pertinent. And it said, Jesus did not spiritually bypass his humanity. He wept, slept, ate, set boundaries, and fully lived in a body. He died in a body. He rose in a body. He loved us by offering his body. For trauma survivors in particular, and I would say anyone who struggles in mental health, I think of what it means that our God knows what it's like to exist in a body, an abused body at that.
Amen.
Jesus could have come so many ways, but he chose to show us how deeply we are loved by joining us in our humanity, our God with us. So why do we bypass our feelings? When we bypass our human experience, we're almost sure to bypass the human experience of others. I first started coming to this church when my oldest daughter was about 6 months old. And one of the things I immediately loved about this church was this sense of family that I got. There was a warm feeling that I experienced here, and I'm proud to call this my church home all these years later.
Amen.
Amen.
One thing I realized over time, however, was the uniqueness of my experience that may help translate the experience of someone coming into our church who has no ties here. I did not grow up in church. I saw my dad go to church every Sunday. We didn't go with him. I told you he had something and I don't know what it was. And we just didn't go with him. We just watched him go. And then after he passed away, people would take us to church here and there. And then once I got into high school, I started going to church on my own. So I would walk from where we lived to church, and then eventually people would give me rides and things like that. But that was my journey to church and to Christ. It was more individual, I guess. Like I said, I didn't grow up in church. I wasn't a drug baby. I wasn't drugged to church. So it's very much a choice of mine to be here. And given my childhood and my story leading up to joining the church, it was easy for me to feel like an outsider coming here. This is a church built on a lot of familial ties. I think even up to recently, sometimes I find out somebody's related to someone else and I'm like, what? I had no idea. And so though there were a handful of people who really did take me under their wing when I got here, that wasn't my total experience. And the truth is that we're all human, so there's going to be rifts, there's going to be tensions, there's going to be misunderstandings in our church.
Mm-hmm.
And as I've soaked up the messages over the past few months that Brother Boss has done on this mental health series, the thing that stood out to me the most was that we need to be reminded that we are inherently created for connection. And we need to do better at that here if we're going to have an impact outside of here.
Amen.
We won't be perfect, but we can make progress. Mm-hmm. So if people are struggling with their mental health and they can't come to church and feel connected, we have a problem. But it's not something that's impossible to fix. Uh-huh. We need to do that. It's not an option, I would say. Mm-hmm. Okay, we can go to the next slide. I'm gonna drink some water too. And you guys can breathe. Hopefully you guys have space to take notes and jot stuff down and Google and stuff. Okay. So I asked the question of why we bypass our feelings. And if we bypass our own feelings, we probably bypass other people's feelings too. So I want us to start thinking of emotions as what they are. They're just information. They're not dictators. We know they're not always factual. I think we saw that in the last slide, actually. That feelings are God-given, they're not good or bad. They're not facts, they're information, and they are an embodied experience that Christ fully understands. So I just put these three little categories together. One, because I like alliteration. It helps us remember things, it helps me remember things. And two, just to give an overall idea that whoever we're encountering is probably dealing with something that falls under one of these umbrellas, whether it be guilt or shame, grief, some kind of loss, or just growing pains, because life is hard. It's not always easy. And it's really important that we develop language around how we feel. I know we don't like to talk about it, but talking about our feelings is important, and having accurate language to describe how we're feeling is also important. Susan David, an award-winning Harvard Medical School psychologist, said that emotional accuracy is crucial. We can place our experiences under these three little G's, but we do need to think about expanding what's going on. So, I don't know, sometimes my kids will say something like, they're just in a bad mood. And I'm like, okay, well, what's the problem? And even they have a hard time figuring out exactly what it is. It may be something happened. It could be that they're just hungry and they just need to figure that out. So it's really important that we get specific about how we're feeling so we can address the actual thing that's going on. Mm. When it comes to other people and their feelings, that can be hard to take in. But if we can consider how hard it is to change ourselves, then we can understand we don't have a good chance of changing anyone else. And that's just something we struggle with. We want to problem solve. We want to give people advice. We want to tell people about themselves. But I want you to consider that God does a lot of listening.
Amen.
Right? We pray, He listens.
Amen.
And sometimes we feel like He's not listening because He doesn't do something, but He's listening.
Amen.
And a lot of times when my students first come into the program, they're learning like being a therapist 101, and they're really shocked to find out what it actually means to be a therapist. It's a lot of listening. It's not a lot of advice giving. It's not a lot of you need to do this or this would make things better. It's really about actively listening. Being able to sit with people's pain, their experiences, their stories, and there's nothing you have to do about it. Absolutely nothing. I hope to shine a light on the ways to help us get a hold of our own process today. In Genesis 3, right in the beginning, as we looked at, those three things popped out. She ate, he ate. They immediately felt guilt and shame around that because feelings are information. They knew they did something wrong. And then there was a grief and a loss of innocence, a loss of all the things you can think of that came about because of their actions. And then there was some growing pains. They had to be removed from that place, and they had to go through some things because of what they did. Okay, we can go to the next slide. Okay. So these are just some examples of things people right next to you may be walking around carrying. And you can think of probably a lot more in detail. things that people feel guilt or shame around, things that people are grieving the loss of, things that are stretching people. And this is a lifelong experience. We're human, so nothing is fixed. God long suffers with us, and he expects us to develop long suffering as well. Galatians 5:22-23 tells us we have access to the fruit of the Spirit. And one of those is patience or long suffering. So we need to get better at doing that with other people. A couple of weeks ago, after my little ones came home from spending time with their dad, Natalie told me she was feeling sad. And she was asking me some hard questions. And this is not new to me. Honestly, I'm not always prepared to respond well. So I offered to read a book with her about divorce. She immediately said yes. It's one of the books I introduced to my kids within the past couple years to help them process the changes that we've been experiencing. Mm-hmm. Although I am a therapist, I knew it would be hard for me to show up for my kids in this way, because this is something I'm processing as an adult with my own big emotions. So the experience is shared, but it's also unique to each of us. So cue the good book. I found a book, I think someone recommended it to me, and if I'm not giving you credit in your hand, I'm sorry, because I don't remember. But it's called It's Not Your Fault, Coco Bear. Oh. A read-together book for parents and young children during divorce. It's by Vicki Lansky. So Natalie curled up next to me, and she read it to me, and we talked, and I asked her questions. And the book's really good because there are questions in there if you just are completely lost and don't know what to say or what to ask. And I asked her at the end how she was feeling after we read the book. Uh-huh. And she said, oh, this makes me feel like I'm not alone.
Amen.
And I can help other people if they're going through this. Mm-hmm. That was a really mature thing of her to say. And it was an emotional moment for me. But it's a prime example of what can happen when we face our hard feelings head on, when we dig down to reach a place of love and safety within ourselves.
Man.
And when we humble ourselves and use the tools we have, and we're willing to show up for someone, no matter what. So yes, we read the book, but obviously I have a relationship with my kids. They know me, I know them, she felt safe to come to me, she was right up under me as she read the book, so all of these things matter. We need connection, we need closeness with people to process the hard things that we're going through in life. And we can go to the next slide. So then what do we do about the three little G's? We're gonna have three big G's. Okay, and what I also love about the story I just told you about my experience with my middle little is that it highlights one of my favorite scriptures, and that's 2 Corinthians 1:3-5. And in the Message version, it says, all praise to the God and Father of our Master, Jesus the Messiah, Father of all mercy, God of all healing counsel. He comes alongside us when we go through hard times, and before you know it, he brings us alongside someone else who is going through hard times so that we can be there for that person, just as God was there for us. We have plenty of hard times that come from following Messiah, but no more than the good times of his healing comfort. We get a full measure of that too. So we need tools to cope with life. We talked about the three little G's, and now I want to talk about the three big G's. Generosity, or gifting, gratitude, and grounding. We are all many parts that make up one body here. And you can jot down 1 Corinthians 12:12-27 and read that later. That gives you a little bit more detail around that. I always say one of the things I love most about my son is how generous he is. And this is something I noticed about him from a very, very young age. He is prone to offer to share right away out of all three of my kids. He offers the first bite, he'll offer the last bite. And it's just inherently who he is. In TK, he had friends, and whenever they had a birthday, he'd come home and he'd say, can I give one of my toys to my friend for their birthday? And he knew them. It wasn't any toy. He knew that friend. He picked a specific toy, and he always wanted to give something of his own away to this friend. And it just really speaks so much about who he is, and I hope he never loses that. He has a lot of joy that he gets in giving to other people. And this is me talking about generosity and gifting. I'm sorry. My first, the big G. And we all have gifts. Mm-hmm. My friend Tiffany, she's gonna hate me for bringing her up, but if I'm sadness, she is joy. She is like sunshine, okay? She is just that friend. Ron, you've heard, he's never met a stranger. Who else? There's so many people we can think of. I have a good friend, Leslie, and she's like a master at synthesizing information. So I'll come to her really overwhelmed, super emotional, because that's my default. And I've been to her, and she just turns all of my emotions into logic and action steps. She's just the master at it. So what is your gifting? Mm-hmm. How can you use what God has planted in you to love God, to love yourself, and love others well? Mm-hmm. Pouring into others can be a healthy way to switch your brain away from your own problems. Amen. And it's not to bypass them, but again, it's to use what you know, use what you have, the way He created you, to pour into other people and switch your brain. And then gratitude. It sounds really cliche to bring up gratitude as a coping strategy, and I have heard it used to bypass people's experiences. Oh, you should just be grateful that. At least you don't. Mm. At least you have. Mm. But those are ways of bypassing how people feel and minimizing people's experiences. On the flip side, I have intentionally put it into practice and found it to be healing. And there's a way to acknowledge how we feel and also hold gratitude in our hearts. It's not either or, it's both and. And I'll give you another example because I'm full of examples today. So I was talking recently to a small group, and I know my oldest daughter was in the group and maybe a couple of the other teens, maybe an adult. I don't know, I carry so many people's stories, sometimes I forget my own. But we were talking about electronics, and I said something about how there was a phase that she went through where I found that she was venting to her friends about me, and it wasn't nice, it was nasty, and I was hurt. And I also knew it was a phase, and it's not happening anymore. And while I was talking about this, Nina interrupted and she said, I forgive you too. First I was caught off guard, like, excuse me? But she was right. She struggled during that time, and I struggled to parent her during that time immensely. Mm-hmm. And she did deserve an apology. I wanted to be defensive. And I think we often do. But kids struggle in middle school, it's a fact. And I was starting to get caught up in this idea or these feelings that I had messed up, I had done something wrong as a parent, or I had failed her. And that's maybe partially true in the moment. I didn't do my best, but it's both. I did mess up. I have messed up a lot as a parent. I will continue to because I'm not perfect. But I also had the thought that I'm really grateful because she was able to openly say that to me. Mm-hmm. I don't have that kind of relationship with my mom. So for her to be able to openly say that, me to take it in and process it, and just to have that level of relationship, I just felt really grateful for that. So although it was hard to hear that I owed her that apology and I hadn't even thought of it at the time, I also felt grateful for the experience that I was having in that moment. So it can be both. We should always acknowledge how we feel and be real with ourselves and others, but we can find something to be grateful for. Mm-hmm. We can find that glimmer mm-hmm. instead of always focusing on the triggers that we have. Mm-hmm. And then grounding. So there's lots of ways to ground ourselves when the world is spinning. And you probably hear about them all the time, especially on social media, but you should actually try to put them into practice. Go outside, in nature, eat. Eat good food if you can, but eat. Sometimes I'm so tired by a certain point in the day, and then I'm like, well, girl, you only drink coffee. I need to eat. Drink water, note to self. If you know me, I don't like water. Don't judge me. Move your body. I don't like water, I'm sorry. Move your body. Stop multitasking and start single tasking so that you can focus. Stop and breathe, literally. Pray, go into the wild. That's our theme for this year. Meditate. put yourself in shared experiences with other people. Small groups like Bible study. Linger longer afterwards. It may be a group you go to in the world in a more personal space. If you have a history of addiction and you go to AA or NA or all those things, but put yourself in spaces where you're having a shared experience with other people. Create routines that support your nervous system and create safety within you and outside of you. So that could be something as simple as making your bed every day. It's something that I have actually adopted in the past probably couple years that is really helpful. It seems silly, but just to come back to my bed at the end of the day made has just improved my mental health. It feels good. Or you probably have routines, like you clean up at the end of the night or whatever that is, but you need some sense of routine and normalcy in your day because life does throw so many things at us. And so whatever's within our control, we can manage that as best we can. Okay, that was a lot. So, how are we doing? Okay, good. All of these things take practice, and they can be easier to practice within community. Remember, progress over perfection. And then we can go to the next slide. So what all this boils down to is that one of the biggest protective factors for our mental wellness is social connection. The foundation of our mental wellness is rooted in our relationship with God, and that's just it. There are no wellness or wholeness without our relationship with Him, without connection.
Amen.
And so I want to encourage you to look within first. Check in with yourself regularly across circumstances and situations and ask yourself some questions like these. Am I being curious or am I being critical? Am I compassionate or am I complaining? Am I operating in legalism or love? And those are things you can start checking in with yourself about first so that you can also practice extending that same curiosity, compassion and love to other people when they come to you with things or you notice things. In Genesis 3, God's love is evident in how He responded to their disobedience. He knew where they were physically. He placed them there. He wanted to know where they were emotionally and spiritually. He wanted to connect with them. And although there were consequences, His ultimate decision to redeem us prioritizes connection. How can we do the same? So, I want to offer a time of practice, a time to reflect on what you've learned or heard or experienced here today so far, and to release something that's not serving you well. I want to offer a time for you to start with your own healing so you can show up for others. So when you got here, and you can move it to the next slide, you got a little sheet of paper, and I don't have one with me, but it's a little rectangle and it's very thin. And that's because it's gonna disappear. Oh, it's okay. Oh, I'll take it. Thank you. So it looks like this. You still have one, Brenda?
Yes.
Okay. So you have a little, if anyone doesn't have one, raise your hand and we can get one to you.
No.
Okay. So you have a little, it's raining. It's raining. I love the rain, you guys. Okay, it's cleansing. So you have your little sheet of paper, and I want you to take a moment to write down something that's causing you pain, something you're grieving, something you're feeling shame over, something you want to release. It doesn't need to be anything big. It could be something really, really small, just one tiny thing, because these things take time. But one thing you can think of that you'd like to hand over to God today, or at least start to hand over to God. And once you're done writing that down, you'll see on either side here is a bowl of water, and there is a big spoon underneath. And you're going to drop your paper in there and stir it around. It's going to disappear. This is just a way to release whatever it is you wrote down between you and God. And then when you're ready, breathe, pray, let it go, whatever you need to do, you're going to pick up something new that I'm going to give you. And I put it over there, I'll show you in a second, but it's a little tiny vial, and there's a mustard seed in it. And that is just a reminder to you to hold on. Hold on to the faith, keep hope. And then I also have some flower stickers, decals, just for you, for whatever you're grieving, whatever you're carrying, that you have a reminder that there are people who love you, who want to walk alongside you and be there for you in that. And you can put it wherever you want, on your laptop, on your water bottle, on your forehead, whatever you want to do with it. It'll be yours to keep. So you're going to release something and exchange it for something new. A mustard seed and some flowers. And I'm going to stand down there to give you the mustard seed and the flowers. And when you're ready, you can start coming up and releasing whatever it is that you wrote on your paper.
Thank you.
Message. How do we love well when we're struggling with our mental health? How is our relationship with God? Are we doing the work to love ourselves so that we can love others well. I hope something I've shared today, something you've experienced, will help you begin or continue on your healing journey. What's one small thing you can do today? At the bottom of the first page on your outline, there's a check out box. So you checked in, now you're gonna check out. You're gonna do a second check-in with yourself. So take a second to check in with yourself again. Notice how you feel. Did anything change? Maybe you feel better. What made you feel better? And this is just something you can do anytime with yourself. No one has to know. Is just identify, acknowledge how you're feeling, and see what you can do to feel better from moment to moment. Go for a walk. Make time to spend with a friend. Send somebody a card. Do something. Externalize those emotions in a positive way, and I bet you'll feel better. And if you don't, that's okay. It's not bad or good, whatever you're feeling. It's just information. It's an opportunity to show yourself compassion, to get curious about what you need to move toward a connection to God, self, and others. We need each other. We won't all be BFFs, but we can be kind, we can be compassionate, loving. We're gonna be flawed, and we should show up anyway. Start with God and yourself first, but the goal is always relationship, because we were created for connection, and our mental wellness depends on it.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
If we go to the next slide, this is a time of invitation. I'm going to let Brother Box take it away. And then also, you got the little glass vials. I have little hooks that you could screw into the top if you want to make like a necklace or put some kind of string on it to hang it somewhere. So you can come to me after service if you would like one of those. Thank you.
Our speaker for sharing with us, sharing part of her life with us. You know, it's tough to get up here and stand for people to share part of your life that, you know, may not have this big smiley face on everything like that, but it's a part of life. You know, and I don't know if you saw on the slide, one of the things she said, you grow through what you go through.
Amen.
I want to thank Ms. Jennifer for being our spokesperson as we continue in this session on mental health, because mental well-being is very important to all of us, you know, and understand that we all have times when we're mentally down.
Amen.
Whether we're stressed out, whether we're dealing with anxiety, whether we're dealing with schizophrenia, whatever it may be, it's a fact of life. God made us, when sin entered the picture, everything that God made that was perfect became imperfect. So don't be ashamed if you're down or whatever. Know that you're not alone.
Amen.
And that's the thing to remember. It's okay not to be okay. It's not okay to do it alone. Connected. We need to be connected somehow in a community, whether it's a faith community, which would be the best place to be, or our healing community, but you need to be connected. And I want to thank Ms. Jennifer for this time. I jotted down a couple of things. She said, we need connections to make it work. She says, we don't have to be perfect at being connected, but we can make progress when we're connected. Amen?
Amen.
And then the other one, just because God doesn't say something or do something doesn't mean he's not listening. And it's that, when she said that, it made me think of the cartoon you always see, or you know, the scene you always see, where the guy or lady's laying on the couch with the psychiatrist, and they're talking, and all they just says, It made me think of that, you know, because God may not say anything, but doesn't mean he's not listening. Because God hears everything we ask. Amen?
Amen.
So we want to again thank Ms. Jim for that today.
Amen.
And I pray you have been blessed. Amen? And on the back of the sheet, if you didn't see, there's some resources again for you as well, for what you might be dealing with. Next week, we'll continue in our series. I think we ended up on the last Sunday this month. And what I'm looking for in last Sunday this month, I'm going to try to have the Department of Health be here on site with some more additional resources if you want to sit down and talk to somebody. So that's what we're looking to end up on the fourth Sunday this month. So pray that works out. Amen?
Amen.
But as you mentioned, we never leave the auditorium of the service of God without offering someone who here an opportunity to come to Christ. There's one here today who's not made a decision to accept Christ, not been baptized into his kingdom. We want to offer you that invitation right now. Because you never know when you get the opportunity or the chance to get. You know, we all realize that there's something greater than this life we're living in now. There's something beyond this life we're living now. God made us for a purpose, and that purpose was for us to spend eternity with him. The only way back for us to God is through Christ. We've not made Christ our Savior. We've not bowed the knee to him. We've not repented of our sins and have been baptized to his kingdom. We're going to miss out on the opportunity. And the Bible tells us to see to it that no one misses out on the grace of God. Amen?
Amen.
So we want to give that opportunity. There's one here who's not made a decision to accept Christ. We offer you the invitation right now to come. We give the invitation all the time, but it's up to you to make a decision to come. If you're debating it, let me tell you, the enemy will always tell you, no. No, you don't need to do this. Wait till you get older or whatever. But you never know when you might have the chance to do it. So the invitation is yours to accept. There's one here today. Church. Amen. And what I want to do is I want to have you stand right here and face front like this. And have everybody come around and give Miss Anita the right hand of fellowship. And welcome, welcome, welcome. All right?
Yeah.
And that's all you got to do is to give her the right hand of fellowship. You don't have to ask where she been and all that. No. Welcome. Amen.
Yeah.
And then we can greet one another and linger longer next door. For those who are going to the community meeting, don't forget your room 301. I know it's raining, but as I said, my father told me, I said, it rains on the army, it doesn't rain in the army. So do what you need to do, amen?
Amen.
Let's stand, let's stand, let's stand. We've been blessed today, we have been blessed. Amen. Father, what a wonderful, 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 glorious time, Father God, we've had here this morning, Lord God. We thank you that we can come together, Father God, first of all, to praise you, Lord God, that you welcome us into your house, Lord God, to sing, lift holy hands, Father God, clap our hands, pat our feet, Lord God, and raise our voices in praise to you, Father God, the God worthy of all praise, Lord. We just pray that all we offer, Lord, is pleasing to you, Father God, because you're the audience, Father God. You're the audience, one, that we give all of our praise, our glory to, Lord God. Thank you, we can come around your table, Lord God. Father God, at the time of communion, Lord God, and share this time, Lord God, knowing, Father, what you paid for us, Father God. Christ, you paid for our sin, Lord God, your own dear Son, Lord. So we thank you for that, Lord God. Pray we get in a way that brings glory and honor to you, Lord God. Father God, that we can participate, Lord God, in the giving of offering and tithes, Lord God, to help your work go forward, Lord God. And then, Father God, to hear, Father God, such an inspirational, Lord God, an informative message, Lord God, tied in the young lady's life as well, Lord. We pray your blessing upon her, Lord, as she continues her journey, Lord God, on her family, Lord God. Father God, may she continue to be a light in this dark world, Lord God. Father God, may she continue to bring up her children the way they should go, Father God, that when they come of age, they too will accept you, Father God, and follow you, Father God, all the days of their life, Lord. We just thank you, Father God, for the courage, Father God, that she shared with us this morning, Lord God. Father God, may it, Father God, be because of the glory, of the power you have in her life, Lord God. May she continue, Father God, just to continue to seek after you, Lord. And Father God, may we all, Lord, do the same. Father, may the message, Father God, resonate with us, Lord God. May it challenge us, Father God, but Father God, may it help us, Father, grow in our faith walk, Lord God, knowing, Father God, that we're okay, Father God, because you're always with us, always beside us, Father God, and you're ready, Father God, just hear our pleading, whatever we call. Thank you for all that have been here this morning, Lord God, those who are looking in, Father God. I pray your blessings in their lives as well, Father. Father God, may we just be, Father God, those who go forth in joy, because we've been in the presence of the Almighty. And we can never leave your presence, Lord God, not knowing we've been blessed. So we've been blessed this morning, Father God. So may you go out and bless others, Father God, with the joy of the Lord that is ours. Be with us, Lord God, and continue to keep us, Father God, in your care. We ask your blessing, Father God, upon the refreshments next door, Lord God. May they, Father God, bring truth and come to the body, Lord God. May conversations, Father God, that are meaningful take place, Lord God. Father God, may new memories, Father God, that are meaningful take place next door as well, Lord. We ask your blessing from the meeting, Father God, from the community committee, Lord, Father. That, Father God, it will be one that's inspiring, Lord God, not empty, Father. And, Father God, as we leave this campus today, may your spirit go with us and keep us in your care until we meet again at the appointed hour and the appointed time. Now may the grace of God and the communion of his Holy Spirit rest, rule about us all now until we meet again. May we all say, amen.